In the very first video, we learned some basics on how to use Docker as a regular user, with a bit of focus on playing CTF. In the second video, we investigated how Docker works by tracing the syscall used to start a container, and we found out that there is this kernel feature called namespaces that facilitates this. On that first video, I got a comment by Daniel Mitre, who wrote, "I made a Docker-like program and a tutorial that made me understand how Docker works. And I remembered seeing that blog post somewhere. I wasn't planning on making a third video about this, but actually, that blog post motivated me. For me, this blog post is an excellent example of what I always try to get across. This playful investigation of technologies for learning purposes. This is why most of my videos are not just typical step-by-step explanations, but they are more like investigations. CTFs reflect that too. They are a playful tool to learn stuff. I feel like this loose and wide approach to learning gets you further and deeper than just being boxed into a topic by some kind of standard tutorial. So let's check out some interesting and playful Docker and Linux namespace resources, and at the end we even look at some Linux kernel source code. So here's Daniel's blog post, Understanding Containerization by Recreating Docker. We choose to implement in C, C++ to call the system calls directly. He explains what namespaces are and shows with sample code how to do it. Here, for example, he looks at the pid namespace like we did last video. The write-up comes with animations showing you everything. So if you want a bit more hands-on and trying it yourself, check out the blog post linked below. I also remembered a similar project called Bocker, Docker implemented in around 100 lines of bash. Yes, it's as terrible as the title suggests, but again, it's not necessarily useful, but it's a fun, playful experiment to learn more. And it can also be a learning resource to you by practicing reading code and seeing how it was done. So let's check it out for a moment. Bocker run is like Docker run, the command to start a container. So here we should see the unshare syscall to create the namespaces. First we see some IP commands, so those are for setting up some networking stuff. Then there is a btrfs command. As we know, Docker containers have their own separate file system structure. If you remember, in the second video we had different etc pastewd inside and outside the container. So we can look up what this command does. Create a snapshot of the subvolume source with the name in the dest directory. So essentially it creates a copy of the prepared file system in the container image so it can be used by the started container. And then eventually we see an unshare. Unshare is basically a command line wrapper for the unshare syscall, so you can easily call unshare from your shell or from a bash script like here. And from the flags we see it creates, for example, a new pid namespace. And then it also chroots, so it changes the root of the file system into the new btrfs path where we copied the file system to, so that for the container it looks like this btrfs file system is the real root file system. Pretty neat. Another interesting command could be bocker exec. As we know, docker exec can be used to execute a program inside of a container. We typically execute bin bash to get a shell inside the container. And you can see the command here is very short. It essentially just nsenter. And I find nsenter a much more fitting name than docker exec. Nsenter run program with namespaces of other processes. Very self-descriptive. Docker exec is so abstract, but namespace enter makes much more sense. So here I have the Docker container running from the last time with the watch process. We also remember that we could look up the actual pid of it with ps on our host, and we can check the namespace of this process in the procfs. So let's try to enter this process's namespace, but instead of using docker exec, let's use nsenter. The flag minus t specifies the target process ID whose namespace we want to join. And then we use the other flags to join all of the different namespaces. Mount namespace, UTS namespace, IPC namespace, network namespace, and our good old pid namespace. But then it executes chroot with the path of the container file system and then executes the command we want. Actually, I'm curious what happens if we join the namespace and don't chroot, because we do have a mount namespace which should isolate mounts from the host system. Let's see, directly bin bash. So here we are. This looks like a typical Docker shell with the Docker hostname, and this for sure looks like our Docker image file system. The mounts also look fine. We see here the Docker overlay FS. So maybe the chroot is just necessary to make Docker work, but not really needed here for Docker. No clue. I'm not that experienced with that stuff. If you know more, let me know in the comments. Anyway, there's a very interesting observation that can be made. We are root. This is special because when you do Docker exec on this container, you are the unprivileged CTF user. This is because in the Docker image, we specified that the user is switched to CTF. But if we directly by hand join these namespaces, we just didn't switch the user. But we could by hand execute su CTF and then we are also the CTF user. I hope it's clear. This is not some kind of vulnerability. We needed to be root to execute nsenter, thus we became root. And then we simply entered that namespace while being root. But it's a cool trick if you need root privileges inside of your container when Docker exec drops down the privileges. For example, maybe you are debugging something and you needed netcat, but it was not installed in the image, and your user inside of the container isn't root, so can't apt-get install something. This can be annoying, remaking the whole image and installing those tools. Instead, you can use nsenter as root to enter the same namespace and then simply install, for example, netcat. When you now try this as a CTF user, it works. Netcat is installed now. I was looking around a bit more for interesting resources and I stumbled over this blog post by Denis Anzakovich, playing with namespaces, writing Docker-aware rootkits. And I really like the first two sentences. Containers aren't really a thing, they are a mishmash of Linux kernelisms like namespaces and cgroups. And I love that because it highlights again that containers are not some kind of isolated system like a VM can be. And this namespace kernel feature mishmash we have also seen. This blog post also talks about something that shouldn't be too surprising, but it underlines again what containers are, or more, what containers are not. Docker containers can run in privileged mode, which allows you to do things like install kernel modules and give you complete access to /dev. If you can see dev SDA in your Docker container, it's probably privileged. You can usually just mount the root file system. So even if you didn't have the root file system inside the container, you can simply mount it again from dev SDA directly. And obviously, if you are root and have the capabilities and privileges to install kernel modules, you can execute code in the kernel and get around any namespace restrictions. And this blog post goes through such an example on a very technical level. Very interesting. It also includes some notes on how to set up a kernel debug environment. I haven't tried it out myself, but seems very interesting. Link is also below. And now at the end, I thought it could be interesting to take a small peek behind the curtain and look at the kernel source code. Because now we have touched upon this pid namespace so much, I thought it could be interesting to look at the getpid syscall. This syscall essentially returns the process ID of the current process, which means if a process is running inside a pid namespace, it should see its fake pid and not the real host pid. So let's check it out. I'm using here Elixir cross-referencer to move around the kernel sources, and we are looking for the getpid syscall entry. The function inside the kernel that is called when you execute the syscall getpid from user space. So search getpid. And then I know it's here in the sys.c file. It's a bit tricky to know where to look if you have never done it before, because there's heavy usage of macros and especially that user length and kernel boundary is special. But here it is. Sys getpid return the thread group ID of the current process. So it calls task tgid vnr with current. Current is the task struct of the current process that called the syscall. The task struct is a big structure containing all the information about the current process. For example, the priority, exit state, the pid, the stack canary, if stack protection is turned on, a reference to the parent process's task struct, references to children, and so forth. Anyway, let's go back to the function task tgid vnr. So it gets passed in the task struct of the current process, and then it calls task pid number ns with the flag pid type tgid. This function has this comment here. The help us to get the task's different pids as they are seen from various namespaces. The namespace wasn't specifically set here, it was null, but we are not looking for the pid as seen from some other namespace, we want to know from our current namespace. So this is just a prototype, the actual function is somewhere else, it's in pid.c. If the ns parameter is not set, it will call this helper function to get the active namespace for this current process. Tasks active pid ns takes the task struct of the current process and gets the task pid of it, which is simply the thread pid of this process. It then looks up the namespace of this process, which can also be found in some member variable of this pid struct, .ns, and returns that. We go all the way back, now we have the reference to the namespace of the current process. And then it calls pid nr ns and passes in that namespace reference, along the pid struct taken from the task struct. And here it almost does the same as the previous function that looked up the namespace reference. It also follows the pid struct into the namespace reference. But here it goes a step further because now it gets the process ID number as seen in this namespace reference. Return that, and eventually we return all that from the syscall back to the user space. So this is how essentially the pid namespace is implemented. Instead of just returning a process ID how it might have been many years ago in old school Linux kernels, you now need to always be aware and need logic to determine which namespace you are in and then getting the correct number. I hope all of this helped you getting an even deeper understanding of Linux namespaces and containers and Dockers. And don't be scared to always investigate and play around with technology. I said it before, the worst thing that can happen is that you accidentally learn something.